word of the Lord, Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 11 through 20, says this. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few men. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate toward the jackal well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. "What is this you are doing?" they asked. "Are you rebelling against the king?" I answered them by saying, "The God of heaven will give us success. We are his servants. We, his servants, will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it." Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for your word and its influence upon our lives, its ability to be living and active and work within us in ways which we do not know or do not see or do not understand. And we pray that would happen this morning. May our interpretation of your word be true. And may you speak to our hearts this morning. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, it's a family morning, fifth Sunday of the month. So kids are going nowhere this morning. You have to sit through this awesome message that you're all going to be hearing. And yes, I love the excitement and enthusiasm. It's beautiful. If you've noticed, apparently I need to put on more deodorant. Nobody wants to sit near the pastor in the front right section this morning. That's good. My wife heard it was blessing of the bikes down across her. She hopped on her Harley and rode down there. Anybody new in here who doesn't get that? If you'd see my wife, you would understand. All right, get to the point here, Scott. Dial it in. We're going to be talking out of this passage today, but there's something that happened before that. But to begin with, I'm going to start by showing you approximately a four-minute video clip. It's from a movie. The movie is called The Book of Eli. I'm just going to give you some preference to this scene. The scene kind of explains itself, okay? So I don't have to give you a whole lot of background, but understand this is a movie that took place in a post-apocalyptic type of society, and there is a man who has with him what you'll soon discover is a Bible. It's the last Bible left on earth, and his mission is to take the Bible west. That is all that he knows from God. So we're going to watch this scene, and then we're going to dial it in a little bit. So go ahead. Now, just a note of reference. If you think, man, this is a really good movie, I'd like to go watch The Book of Eli. Much of the movie is not like that scene. It is very graphic and very violent at times, so do not watch it with your children. But the insight is fascinating, isn't it? And the parallels are just dripping with irony here. You see, when we watch a movie like this, we watch a clip like this, it's easy to look at it and see how God is working through the character and see how he hears God's voice speaking to him. And it's plain as day when we look at that. And when we read through Nehemiah, we see the same thing of God's provision in his life. And we think Nehemiah must have had this really special relationship with God to be able to hear that. And we think that often when we read through many different accounts that we see in the scriptures. We see where God places his servants in different situations, in different circumstances, to be used for his honor and glory. God orchestrates events to that end. And we see that here in Nehemiah, don't we? Now, we didn't read verses 1 through 10 because I really want to focus on what's going on in verses 11 through 20. But had we done that, we would have read about the immense kindness of King Artaxerxes towards Nehemiah as he was sent out on this specific mission. In fact, in chapter 2, verse 6, scriptures record these words, "It pleased the king to send me." You see, we do things in our lives because they're good, because they're right, because they're noble, because they're upstanding. But we don't often do things because they please us. The fact that Nehemiah's sending actually pleased the king, makes me understand that this was not just something that was laid upon Nehemiah's heart, but something that was laid upon the king's heart as well. It connotes an ordained blessing unto Nehemiah for his journey, not just some random thing or happenstance that happened to him. But it also goes a long way into illustrating what we talked about last week, this dynamic relationship between Nehemiah and King Artaxerxes. They were more than casual friends. If you remember, Nehemiah was the cupbearer, but he didn't just work for the king. They had a relationship. They had a friendship. They had a love for one another. You see, the success of Nehemiah's calling was so important to his friend that the king was willing to allow one of his most entrusted advisors to leave for this calling. We talked last week, I said about their intimacy and the trust in their relationship that they enjoyed with each other. But I want you to think about it this way. If you want to love somebody or show somebody how much you love them, you know what the best thing you can do for them is? The thing that will test your relationship more than anything is not to love them more and to hold them close, but it's to let them go. Now, that doesn't mean like, okay, me and my spouse kind of had that a little bit last night. You know, I think this afternoon I'm going to hit the road and go out for a little bit. That's not what I'm talking about. Let me give you an example. When I was 16 years old, I went to my parents and I said, you know what? I want to go on a missions trip, a summer missions trip. It's going to involve a couple weeks of training down in boot camp in Florida, and then I'm going to go overseas for about 7 or 8 weeks. So all in all, I'm going to be gone for about 2.5 months. 16 years old. 16 years old. Going with a missions organization, but a group of people that we had never met before that I didn't know of, that I'd heard good stuff about, and they literally let me go halfway around the world. Not that they just let me go, they encouraged me to go. They helped me raise funds. They helped me get support. They helped me get all my stuff together. See, that showed a lot more love than if they had said, you know what, Scott, that's kind of out of our comfort zone, and we're really not okay with that. We want you to stay home this summer because that's where we feel you're safe and secure. It's a lot harder to let go than it is to hold on. You know, I had a friend when we moved up here. He wrote me a card, wrote me a letter, and made it himself. And just talked about how much our friendship meant to him and how hard it would be to see us move a couple hours away. And I knew it, and I felt very much the same way for him. But you know what cemented that friendship is the fact that we've been up here almost 6 years now, and almost every single month, that friend makes a trip up to visit. It happens for a year, maybe two, but we're going on 6 now, and there's no signs of it slowing down. And maybe that's easy for me to be like, okay, good for him, right? But we just had friends leave this area that we were very close with and go somewhere else. So we're on the other side of it now where you do the sending, and the letting go is the hard part. If you're the one who's sent and you're called, then it's easy to do the leaving. If you're the one who's doing the sending, it's hard to let go sometimes. I wasn't here for it, but my guess it would be what many of you felt when Chad and Beth left to go on missions many years ago if you were around for that time. The fact that Artaxerxes allows Nehemiah to leave, but not just allows him, but blesses him in doing so, is an incredible bond between the two of them and something God is working in his life. Verse 12 is interesting as we get into it today. Verse 12 says, I set out during the night with a few men. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. Now, as we just talked about, he met in verses 1 through 10 of chapter 2 with Artaxerxes, the queen. They knew about it. People knew. In fact, Artaxerxes blessed Nehemiah's journey. He didn't just bless him. He gave him paperwork to get there safely on his journey. And not only that, he gave him paperwork so that Nehemiah could go to the king's forest and get trees to rebuild any gates, to rebuild any walls. For anything he needed to do, the king blessed him. So when Nehemiah says, nobody knew what God had placed upon my heart, what the scripture is making sure here is that we know that nobody in Jerusalem had yet known what was placed upon Nehemiah's heart. It wasn't public knowledge there at this point. And it was very much supported by the king. But you know what? Not everybody supported Nehemiah's mission. Verse 10 says what? We didn't read verse 10, but if we did, verse 10 says, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Historical records would indicate that this Sanballat guy was the governor over Samaria, a political figure, a rival of Nehemiah, if you will. Tobiah was probably the governor of Transjordan. He would have been under the Persian rule, but an official nonetheless. They both had political clout, and they were disturbed that Nehemiah was sent to Jerusalem. This project was not only Nehemiah being sent, but Nehemiah being blessed by the king. Maybe you're thinking, that doesn't sound too bad. But you got to understand, being blessed by King Artaxerxes was one that Nehemiah brought that benefited the Israelites, which meant by extension that it was a loss of power and a loss of control for Sanballat and for Tobiah. Now, let me put it in perspective for you. We have two ruling political groups in our country right now. And I know many of us say we want a third, or we want another option, this, that, but let's be honest. Two ruling groups, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. And when the Democratic Party is in control, they don't want to lose control. And when the Republican Party is in control, they don't want to lose control. And we just voted for a president not that long ago. I actually got caught up in a traffic jam in Harrisburg last night. It was miserable. I'm driving down 81, right where it merges with 83, about 7:45 p.m. Dead stop in the road. Traffic as far as I can see. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. There was no accident. Our president was at the farm show. And apparently, what I didn't know is when a president comes into an area, the traffic coming from every direction on every single road stops up until that point. Interesting enough, has nothing to do with message. But anyway, I was a little grumpy, but I got over it. It's okay, right? When you vote for a political party, or you vote for a president, you're not just voting for the president, you're also voting for the vice president that accompanies that person along. Maybe you don't know what the vice president does. Maybe you think it's just a figurehead position. But there are some very important roles that the vice president does. The vice president sits as president over the Senate. They reside over the affairs of the Senate, which means they're in control of the Electoral College and making sure that that voting gets done correctly and properly. But more importantly, if there is a 50-50 tie, a dead even tie in the Senate, do you know whose vote breaks that tie? The vice president. So if you're the Republican Party and you're in control, you want a Republican vice president to come in. If you're the Democratic Party and you're in control, you want a Democratic vice president to come in. And when there's a shift in power, there's what? Tension. You don't like to lose power. You don't want that controlling vote being held by the other party. That's what's going on for Sanballat and Tobiah here. I just wanted to give you a little reference because there's a threat to their power by Nehemiah showing up in Jerusalem. At least a perceived threat on their end. And one of the things I love about this passage, one of the true miracles of it, if you can read over it, and sometimes you just gloss right over it, is, and it must be good to be the king, right? Because the king didn't have a political party to answer to. The king's just like, look, either like it or hit the road, right? He didn't care who he offended. He wanted what was best for his friend Nehemiah. It was worthy to Nehemiah, so it was worthy to Artaxerxes. I love the fact that God laid this mission not on Nehemiah's heart alone, but on the heart of the king as well. And I think that is truly one of the easily read over miracles of this passage, because it doesn't make a lot of sense that it would work that way. So what exactly do we have going on in verses 11 through 20? Nehemiah shows up at Jerusalem. He rests for 3 days. He hops on his mount at night and goes out and checks out the outer perimeter or the outer walls of Jerusalem with a few men. He was riding a donkey or a mule. Everybody else was on foot. There were no mounts except with me, except the one I was riding on. He takes surveys of the walls. He takes surveys of the gates surrounding the city, the devastation that was brought upon them. But what we know about this is what we read last week in chapter 1, verse 3 says what? Those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. I want you to understand, Jerusalem was not empty at this time. The city was not completely abandoned. It wasn't like there wasn't anybody around. The exiles had returned, but what had they returned to? A city that was in disrepair. Sure, some attempts had been made at it, but nothing of progress had been noted. The city was broken down. Because the city was broken down, there was no protection for the Israelites. There was no protection for the people living in it. They were exposed on every front. There was no security in their lives. And this is a big deal. And it's very difficult to operate under those conditions. They were subject to the dangers of an unsettled lifestyle and no protection. It's interesting. You could almost say that they were probably living without hope in their lives. Anytime somebody wanted something, a stronger force, a stronger band of raiders could come into the city and take what they wanted. And when you see people living without hope in their lives, it shows in their attitudes and actions, doesn't it? You can see it in their eyes. You can see it in pictures and videos on the faces of survivors in war-torn countries walking around in just unbelievable disbelief of what happened. You can see it when you look into to the eyes and the pictures and the videos of the eyes of children and people who live in countries where there is famine and impoverished nations. You can see it if you take a day trip down to Washington, D.C. and get a pass to the Holocaust Museum. And don't just walk through the Holocaust Museum and see what went on and learn about what went on, but take time to look at the pictures and the videos and look at the blank stares looking back at you of those who were in the concentration camps. There is no hope. There is very little life in their eyes. It has been stripped away over time. That's what life without hope looks like, and that's much of what was being experienced by the Israelites in exile who had returned to Jerusalem. And if we were able to travel back to the book of Exodus chapter 5 today, we'd be able to see a different example of this when it happened. You see, the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt making bricks, and Moses came back on the scene and did some stuff. God did some stuff, some miracles that upset Pharaoh. And Pharaoh says, you know what? Not only are you now enslaved where you're making bricks every day, I'm going to make you make bricks every day without providing you the supplies. You got to go out and find your own straw, but you still have to meet the same quota. You still have to make as many or you will be punished accordingly. That was what was given to the Israelites. That was the instruction given to them. And what did they say after hearing this from Pharaoh? What did they say to Moses and Aaron? They held Moses and Aaron accountable for this. You guys did this to us because you performed these miracles. May the Lord look upon you and judge you. You have made us a stench to Pharaoh and his officials and have put a sword in their hand to kill us. You see, the Israelites were in Egypt, and they were a people living resigned to their fate. They were a people that were living without hope. That's how these people were in Jerusalem at the time. But we get to verse 17 and 18. And Nehemiah says, come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace. I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me and what the king had said to me. It's obvious that Nehemiah sees something different when he looks at Jerusalem. He sees something different when he looks at this project. He sees something different when he looks at the opportunity for building a wall. He sees God's protection and provision upon the mission. Where ruin and destruction lie, Nehemiah still sees the hope. And when you read through this, if you're anything like me, you go, man, I wish I could feel that way. Man, I wish I could look at ruin and destruction and see hope. I wish I could see God in the middle of it all the time. Why can't we live with the certainty that God is directing our steps and lives for his good and perfect will? You know, in the book of Eli, this movie that I just showed you a clip from, there's another interaction between these two characters where the girl asks Eli, she says, you know, you say you've been walking for 30 years, right? He says, yeah. She says, have you ever thought that maybe you were lost? He says, nope. Well, how do you know that you're walking in the right direction, she asks. I walk by faith, not by sight, is his reply. And she asks him, what does this mean? And I love his response. He says, it means that you know something even if you don't know something. She said, that doesn't make any sense. And he says, it doesn't have to make sense. It's faith. You know something even if you don't know something. Now, let's be honest here. That phrase isn't going to score you a whole lot of points on a doctrinal thesis or a theological dissertation. But there's a profound truth in that phrase, isn't there? There's a profound truth to what faith is. This is how we want to feel, to have that rock-solid assurance that God is guiding and directing our steps. But instead of feeling like Eli, so many of us, in another movie analogy here, feel like Ray Kinsella or Kevin Costner's, you know, character from Field of Dreams. We're just walking around a cornfield and voices are talking to us saying, if you build it, they will come. And we're going, where is this coming from and where am I supposed to go? How does faith flesh itself out in your life? I was listening to a fascinating message this week. It was on a podcast on the internet, and this guy was making an amazing analogy. He was a speaker. I don't even know how old the clip was. It looked like it could have been 20, 30 years old, speaking to this huge audience. And apparently the guy goes to a lot of different colleges and universities and debates apologetics and things of that nature, why God is real, why God is true, and things of that nature. And he said one of the questions he always gets asked when he goes to universities is if there is a God and God loves us so much, he said, why do bad things happen? Not just bad things happen to good people. If God loves us so much, why do bad things happen? It's a question many of us face and have dealt with or will deal with at some point in our lives. And he said, I never answer that question until they ask it the proper way. And they say, no, it's my question. He said, no, you got to ask it the right way before me to answer it. He said, the right way is what you really want to ask is, how can a loving, holy, and perfect God not kill me in my sleep because he knows everything that I've done the day before, the thoughts that have gone through my head, the actions I've gone, and the things that I have spoken. When he sees the sin in my life and chooses not to kill me and yet lets me live anyway, how can that holy God let good things happen? He said, because there's a difference in the way you look at it. He said, when I ask the question, why do bad things happen to people, or why do bad things happen to good people, he said, my point of view is that I'm taking it from a person's point of view. And that people are the Almighty and people are in control. And if I want control of my life, then I ask the question of why does God let bad things happen to people? But if God is in control of your life, that's not the question that needs to be asked. So the question I want to ask you this morning is, do you have a God-centric view of your world and your life, or do you have a self-centric view of your world and your life? And that's not a question you can answer with your mouth. It's not a question that you can reason through with your head. It is a question that will be answered by the life that you live. The differences are easy to spot, aren't they? In much of my morning studies in my Bible, I've been reading through the Old Testament. Numbers chapter 13. 12 Israelite spies were sent into Canaan. Go and see the land and report back what is up. 12 of them went. And what were the responses of the spies when they came back and reported to Moses? The people who live there are powerful. The cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there, basically this giant type of people. 10 of the spies reported this. And what were they really saying when they said these words? If we read between the lines, what were they saying without saying it? This land is awesome. It's phenomenal. It's beyond our wildest dreams. But there is no way we can take it over because we would get slaughtered and destroyed if we tried, and we are scared. But Caleb steps up and says, hold on a second. He says these words, we should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. And the other 10 spies get scared at Caleb's response because it's based upon fear. And their response is based upon fear. Caleb's response is based upon God. Self-centric versus God-centric. So what do they say to the people? The other 10 say, we can't attack those people. They are stronger than we are. The land we explored devours those living in it. All the people we saw there are great in size. We seemed like grasshoppers in their eyes. And we look the same in our own eyes, and we look the same to them. And it says, because of that report, the people rebelled against Aaron and Moses again. Fast forward our passage to today. Nehemiah is being mocked by three guys, Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem. What is this you're doing? Are you rebelling against the king? And what was Nehemiah's response? The God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim of historic right to it. A God-centric view. It wasn't because Nehemiah was so great. It wasn't because this process was so great. It was because his eyes were focused on God, not focused on himself. Translation, Nehemiah's like, get out of the way and let God work. Step aside and let God do what God needs to do to accomplish his task. Your lack of faith, your unbelief, your self-centric worldview has absolutely no business here right now. Not only does it not have any business here now, it doesn't have any business in the future either. You see, Nehemiah's sense of pride, Nehemiah's vision didn't come from a sense of pride or internal priorities he had set for his life. And we hear all the time about our plans for the future. I mean, I address it constantly. I had a premarital counseling session this week with a couple. You know, I'm asking them, what are your relationship goals? What are your financial goals? What are your future plans? And if we're honest with ourselves, we all do this in our personal, professional lives. And you know what? It's good. It's good to have a plan. It's good to plan for the future. It's good to look into those things. The problem is we also do it on our faith journeys. And when we do it on our faith journeys, it can lead to misplaced dependency and status. And maybe you're sitting there thinking right now, well, yeah, I know this church that does that, and they do those things. And we're thinking about the other people or the other churches, the other bodies that we know that do those things. Lest you think we are immune to this phenomenon, let me ask you one simple question. What has God done in the life of this church body or a group of believers since I have been pastor here almost 6 years that we couldn't have accomplished on our own? What has happened in your personal faith journey that you couldn't have accomplished on your own? That's the difference between a God-centric view and a person-centered view. And that question hurts, doesn't it? Hurts me. But here's the thing. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Nehemiah is operating on faith. Faith in his circumstance, faith on his journey and his purpose, faith in the task to which God has called him to, but more and most importantly than anything else is what? Faith in God himself, that he is and was and will be who he says he is. That God has the power of provision, but most of all, the desire to see his perfect purpose being accomplished through less than perfect vessels. Paul sums it up very nicely in Romans chapter 8, verse 31. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? You see, Nehemiah took a walk around the wall that evening, and what did his inspection of the wall reveal? Jerusalem lies in ruins. Its gates have been burned with fire. And although he didn't tell anybody else, God had placed this upon Nehemiah's heart to fix the wall. This was way beyond Nehemiah's abilities, his level, or his comprehension at this point. It was something so large and so audacious that he would have been thought as half mad had he verbalized this to the people, or maybe fully mad had he told the people what was on his heart. But when the timing was right, he revealed it. What has God placed upon your heart that you have not told anybody about? You see, I ask the question in that specific way because when we tell somebody about what we think God has placed upon our hearts, we become accountable to that person, and that makes us uncomfortable. They now possess this knowledge of what may seem like some crazy, outlandish thing that is going through our minds that we think God might be calling us to. And I can tell you for a fact that Satan does not want you to share what you think God has placed upon your heart with one another or another fellow believer. Because when you share those ideas, people start getting inspired. People start getting and living and acting on faith. We get a God-centered worldview. So Satan wants us to keep those ideas to ourselves, where they might be marinating and comfortable in our minds. We don't have to worry about them a whole lot. And we don't bring these ideas out. Why don't we do them all the time? Because we don't want to look embarrassed or ashamed if God doesn't come through for us. We don't want to make Christians look bad or ruin the name of Christ if we somehow mess up. We are scared that the voice we hear isn't really the voice of God leading us, but some other voice of the world. See, what I love about that clip from the book of Eli at the beginning is what? I know what I heard. Do you know what you hear? There's an easy way to figure it out. It's not a mystery. It's not rocket science. If the voice you hear in your head matches up with what's inside these pages, it's the voice of God and the Holy Spirit speaking to you. If it doesn't, it's not. It sounds so simple, but so profound, right? And I know there's a lot of extra stuff added onto that. But so often we like to stay safe. We like to stay comfortable. We like to stay in our self-sufficient bubbles because we hate the why question. We hate it when our toddler children figure it out. Maybe we don't hate initially, right? It's fun at first. Why? Oh, because, right? But after like a day and a half of why, and you get to the 26 of whys and you finally just go, because I said so, the why question gets to be enough is enough. And we're done with the why phase, but you've only got a year and a half left of it. The why, though, is so powerful in our lives. And when I worked in youth ministry, the kids in the youth group knew that anytime they answered a question, anytime, there was always the why. So I would ask a question, somebody would answer, why? I wouldn't keep giving them the whys, I would just give them one why. But to every question that was answered, the why would come after it. You see, the why reveals the heart of our lives and our intentions. Nehemiah's why was what? His why was, this is what God has put upon my heart. In the book of Eli, his why was his faith in God. What has God placed upon your heart to do for him, and why? It was funny, like I said, I was doing a premarital session, counseling session this week, and a story had come up that I had forgotten about, Laurie and I hadn't talked about for years, but it just brought back really good memories to us. It was great, because it was a story where I got to do something for my wife where it was one of those things you always want to do. You always want to do something special, something that really stands out and something cool. You know what I'm thinking? Wow, wouldn't it be cool like some week to just like, or some day that I come home from work and be like, hey, by the way, I made trip plans. We're going to like Jamaica for the next week and a half and I already packed your bag and this and that. So we're going to drive and the kids are taking care of you. Like you think about these grand, great things and yeah, we don't have the money to do that, but that's okay. But one time what happened that was really cool was we had just, after we sold our first townhouse and moved into the house in New Holland, we made money off of it. And so one night, you know, we got, I forget whose parents to watch the kids. There was only two of them at that time, I think. And I took Laurie out for dinner, and then I gave her this envelope. It's not that sentimental. It's not that gooey, so I don't know why I'm crying, but I am. Because the intention behind it was, my wife is so giving to other people that she doesn't take time for herself. So I took her to probably my favorite store, but also one of her favorite stores, a place called Eastern Mountain Sports, like outdoors goods. And they have, but every time we go into EMS, she would always go, I would love to have one of these shirts. I would love to have one of that, but they're just so expensive. So I put $200 in the envelope, which was a lot of money for us at the time. Still is a lot of money for us. And I wrote 10 rules on the front. And some of the rules went like this. You must spend this money in this shopping trip here tonight. Once you walk into the store, if you have any money left over, it comes back to me and you lose it. You must spend this money on yourself. You may not buy anything for anybody else at any other time. One of the rules was you are not allowed to feel guilty about spending this money. I mean, I laid it out, you know, and I forget what all 10 of them were. But she talked about this during our counseling session with this couple. And it was so neat for me to see because she was telling the story. And I, like I said, I'd forgot about it. Her face lit up, grinning from ear to ear, big smile. And you could see like the light behind her eyes. And I don't think she has any of those clothes anymore. I don't think she has one thing from that shopping trip. I think she spent like $197. She got really close. I mean, she did very well. And I thought about that, and I thought, why did I do that? I did it because I wanted to make Laurie happy. I wanted to show her how much I loved her. What made me happy was seeing that years later it still impacted her. She smiles when she tells the story, not because of the clothing that she bought that night. She smiles when she tells the story because of the love and the faithfulness that her husband expressed to her through that simple act. So I ask the question one more time, what has God placed upon your heart to do for him that will make him smile in that way as well? Would you bow your heads with me? Father, thank you for all you do for us. Thank you for speaking to us, for meeting with us, for sending your son for us, and for sending your spirit for us. God, if you have laid something upon our hearts, help us to be true and faithful to the calling which you have entrusted us. Help us to not keep it to ourselves. Speak to us clearly so that we know it is your voice speaking and not the voice of the world or the voice of Satan. Help us to be diligent in following after you and to love you with our hearts. And help us to lift one another up and hold each other up in all we say and all that we do. Help us to be a body of believers that madly and passionately in love with you. We ask these things in Christ's name.